In the outskirts of Nairobi, Kenya, four young leaders, Chris, Dan, David, and Carrie, are changing the world. 6 years ago, in the slum of Huruma, motivated by a desire to serve their community and respond to God's calling, they started a small tutoring program to assist a few poverty-stricken orphans. That program is now known as the Faraha Community Center and has grown to assist 550 orphans. They run a successful primary school, extend microloans to orphan guardians, provide a healthcare clinic for those afflicted with HIV and other diseases, and they keep vigilant watch over the orphan's home life and needs. And they're not done. Most recently, many tiny bellies that had once gone without food for days now receive one meal a day in school through their recently launched feeding program. With the help of continued resources and God's guidance, their goal is to provide safe homes for boys and girls who are vulnerable and at risk to abuse. To expand their educational facilities to accommodate higher grade levels, and to eventually become self-sustaining. In one word, they provide hope so that orphans like Moses, Bromwell, Pauline, Jemima, and Patrick can feel the love of family and truly dream about what they want to be when they grow up. They don't walk as if they're walking through open sewer streets congested with sheet metal shacks with no electricity and no clean running water. They walk ever grateful, always prayerful, as if God is with them, because He is. They walk as if they're walking on holy ground.
This is Pauline.
My name is Pauline Bonnet.
Pauline Bonnet
is 10 years old. She is studying at Furaha Community Center. She is in class 3. And she is a total orphan. She is staying with her grandmom. So here is the place.
Pauline lives in one small room with her grandmother and sister Diana.
So here is the Pauline and the sister Diana, yeah. And the grandmother.
Her grandmother used to sell necklaces, but after the post-election violence in January 2008, she lost many customers and does casual labor to make ends meet.
She can't afford to have meals. Even to have one meal a day is a problem to Pauline's body. So this is their bathroom.
Before Pauline heads off to school, she washes her face in a faucet shared by the whole floor of the building down the hall from their room.
They are searching for shoes.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Pauline puts on her uniform and finds their shoes by candlelight.
Okay, you got it? Okay, Pauline. I want you to walk to school like you would normally walk to school.
Classes began at 7 a.m. at the Faraha Community Center. On her way to school, Pauline explains that math and CRE, Christian religious education, are her favorite subjects.
Math and CRE.
What's CRE?
The name of God.
In the name of God.
Uh-huh. Our focus was to make these orphans get education, because education is the key to life. Is the key to many things.
Education is the key to these orphans realizing their dreams, and education is one of the four key departments that the leaders of Faraha Community Center direct. David is the director of education this year.
First session will be that introduction, and then we'll give you time.
Faraha, we have different programs and activities that run in our center. Under education department, we have the primary school and the library falling under that department.
Do you talk when the teacher talks?
Oh, ongea mwalimu akiongea.
Yes.
You no. do? No. You don't talk to your friend? No. No.
Under the Education Department, Faraha operates a primary school from nursery through class 5, class 5 accommodating 12 to 13-year-olds. Though the orphans have the option of attending public schools, they often do not, due to fees. The Kenya government states that public schools are free, but primary school costs about $166 per year, plus the cost of mandatory uniforms and books, and secondary school costs twice as much. This is not an option for a guardian barely able to make rent and provide food every few days. The Faraha Community Center has reached maximum capacity with 400 students at their current location, and with sponsorship, they assist 150 orphans attending public schools.
Our school at the moment can only accommodate a certain number of kids. Now we need to create room for more.
David expressed that one of their immediate educational goals is to expand to include class 6 through 8 to fully prepare students for their secondary education, and to also include vocational training. For many, their dreams of becoming a pilot, teacher, doctor, or mechanical engineer are waiting at the door of the University of Nairobi, just 2 miles away. In time, for those that show great promise, scholarships can be considered. For others, vocational training and life skills will better equip them in a city with 50% unemployment, where many fall victim to gangs and commercial sex work. David, now 26 and the firstborn of 5, is no stranger to the challenges of school fees and achieving a higher education.
I had to drop out.
David had to drop out of a medical program in 2001. He and his family were unable to continue to pay the tuition.
Fundraising. He had to drop out and drop my studies at that level.
But eventually he returned in 2002 to take some business classes. He felt that God tested and molded him to ultimately choose to serve his community.
People here and there in the community, Lord, open our eyes, Lord. Put down some love in us and some care in us, Lord Jesus.
The challenging part is having all of them looking up on us for guidance and for some resources that we know are limited, and just to put an inspiration in their heart but not lie to them, that makes it hard, because you have to inspire them with assurance that whatever you're saying, whatever you're dreaming of and hoping, you believe is what will be coming up in future.
There was violence, as reported by NBC.
Kenya voted for a new president.
Kenya's ongoing tribal violence is it being fueled by gangs paid to kill on the orders of the country's politicians?
The government of Kenya.
Kenya. Tens of thousands took to the streets to accuse President Mwai Kibaki of stealing Thursday's election.
Back in December of 2007, Kenya faced inner turmoil as tribal violence struck the nation in the midst of a disputed presidential election. The government banned opposition demonstrations, but what followed for weeks to come was unspeakable violence, resulting in 1,500 people being killed and 600,000 displaced. The lives of the leaders, orphans, and guardians of the Faraha Community Center were not only in danger, but deeply affected. You hear Kenyans refer to this period as post-election violence. After the post-election violence, the leaders and the social workers were introduced to one young boy, Moses.
Yeah. Where are you schooling?
Faraha Community Center.
Where do you, how do you come to Faraha Community Center?
English is a neighbor.
Like this Moses here, he was brought with a neighbor, a good neighbor, because he was asking the neighbor, his neighbor, I want to go to school, where will I go? He came to Nairobi last year, November, to come and visit his brother. And after election, it was 29th December when the...
Moses had been living with his older brother prior to the election.
So since that day, his brother went for a job on that day. He never comes back. Till now, the brother has never turned.
Even Moses himself does not know where the brother went to.
whether he's dead, whether he's arrested, he doesn't.
Moses continued to live in the same home with no way to pay the rent of $13 a month and pay for food.
This is the bathroom, and they do the washing outside here.
The Faraha Community Center staff has taken him under their wings and chip in from their own pockets to help pay his rent and for a little food. He is a desperate case, and there is much concern for his emotional well-being.
And even rural area where he came from, there is nobody, it's a lot of graves. It's full of graves, no houses, nobody there. So this child here is traumatized about the situation, and also he's worried about the brother.
Uka. Moses, how are you?
Moses now attends class 5 at the Faraha Community Center, but does not yet have the $8 to buy a uniform.
So this is his school uniform, and this is only the clothes he has. So he washed them at night and then put them in the morning.
Moses has very good math skills and hopes to be a mechanical engineer. The Faraha Community Center hopes in the future to provide safe homes for boys and girls where they can live in a community with close support of social workers.
In fact, we need a safe house, whereby such cases, Moses, can find a way of helping them.
Carrie is the director of social and justice issues and knows very well that besides Moses' circumstances, there are many cases which require special attention and urgent care, such as orphans who are abused, violated, and victims of rape.
I am an orphan. I'm an orphan, and I like also orphans. And I think God gave me that passion. Love the orphans.
Married with an 18-month-old little girl, he is recognizing the importance of family and community.
We need, if there will be a safe home in Faraha, it will help Moses a lot. It's good if he can find somewhere he can mingle and play with other kids like him. He's so isolated because of where he is right now, because he's alone.
This is Bromwell.
We're gonna get him coming up the walkway. Okay? So can you wait here until I go like this to you, okay?
Mama. Okay. Ay bana. Nini.
Bana.
There are some orphans who at a young age are beginning to stand out among their peers as leaders. Bromwell, currently in class 4, has been described as very bright and likes to journal.
He's a very
active
bright
boy.
And active.
Active boy. Yeah.
He's our journalist. We call him a journalist because he's tell us so many things.
He's also described as very active and respected by his peers.
My honor, I promise that I will do my best to do my duty to God and to my country, to help other people at all times, and to obey the scout's will.
At 11 years old, he is third in his family of 5 children with a single mom trying to make ends meet. Like many families, they share one room, tight quarters for sleeping, eating, and even bathing. They bathe in a house and then just mop the floors. Some living spaces use community showers outside.
You bring a bucket?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Okay.
Okay.
He's bathing.
I'm bathing, yeah.
He's doing a demonstration.
Water. Is it okay?
I'm peeking.
Yeah. I'm peeking. I'm peeking.
Bromwell's mom purchases water for cooking and bathing, which can get expensive. There is no toilet, and options are limited to paying to use community toilets, borrowing from a neighbor's flat, are using what's called the flying toilet.
The flying,
the flying ones.
The flying.
You go, you use the paper, the polythene paper, and then you go and throw the river is here.
Oh, somebody's roof.
From the roof.
Yeah, you so throw. You don't care where it lands.
Though Bromwell is making the most of his education, he, like many orphans, is being looked after by a single parent or guardian who is ill.
The mother? And she's single.
Bromwell's mom has severe asthma and is unable to work. Many guardians who are ill, especially HIV positive, are assisted by the HIV AIDS therapy program of Faraha Community Center, currently ran by Chris. Chris works tirelessly with the healthcare workers to serve the 40 clients that currently attend the healthcare program.
As I told you, my name is Amanda Lumidi, infected with HIV virus. That's why I put on this t-shirt and I love it so much.
Even kwa sababu amevaa ile t-shirt na naipenda sana.
When I tell you I'm HIV positive, when the bank I ask you, I know, do you? On September 27th, I'll be celebrating my 40th birthday. And life begins at 40. Okay, when I discovered I was HIV positive, it was back in the year 2000. I didn't know what to do.
Sikujua ni nini nitafanya.
I was confused.
Nilikuwa nimechanganyikiwa.
A very beautiful lady like me.
Wow. Mwanamke mzuri kama yeye.
Educated.
Ambaye amefunda, amesoma.
In fact, married.
Atena ameolewa.
From a Christian background.
Katika shirika sana.
Very faithful.
Ambapo alikuwa mwaminifu.
I was infected with the virus.
Bas.
The Faraha Community Center wishes to one day soon become an NGO, non-governmental organization, to extend their humanitarian efforts and advocacy on behalf of the orphans to a national level.
I and the rest, we are working on the strategic plan, because we need, as Faraha, we need to help so many people. So when you make it an NGO, we can reach so many people. Not only in Huruma community, but maybe the entire Nairobi or the entire Kenya.
Jamima, 6 years old, walks to school each day with the comfort of a mom who works hard and is the recipient of a microloan funded by the Finance Department of Faraha Community Center. The students at Faraha Community Center not only benefit from free education, but some also benefit from the growing popularity of microloans. Unfortunately, her father was poisoned during the post-election violence. Jamima, one of six girls, continues her education with a roof overhead, clothes, and food. Jamima will tell you that her favorite subject is environment, that she loves art on Mondays, and her favorite teacher is Teacher Nancy.
Environment. The subject unapenda. Unapenda teacher mgani shule?
Nancy.
Teacher Nancy.
Jamima's mom is running a business making flatbread similar to tortillas, which she started with a microloan. When businesses do well, guardians are able to pay rent, sustain their families with food, buy clothes and shoes for the kids, and hopefully expand their business.
Natembeza.
Okay. She doesn't have a specific...
The finance department at Faraha, which runs the microloan program, is currently led by Dan.
Microloan program. She makes ornaments. They are rich in traditional Kenyan setup. So she makes them by herself and sells them mostly to the tourists.
One of the guardians who are affected by post-election violence.
This guardian used to have an embroidery shop, but it burned down during the post-election violence. She has six children of her own and takes care of four orphans that attend the Faraha Community Center. She has always had the talent and desire to do this kind of work, and now is made possible through the microloan program. It is difficult to grow produce within the slums without running water, and water jugs are expensive. This guardian buys vegetables from a larger market in bulk very early in the morning and transports them to Aruma to her stand.
She's saying that she was able to increase her stock and get more profit, and now she can assist the orphan that she's living with alongside her own kids.
This woman has run a vegetable stand for 20 years just getting by, but after receiving a microloan to invest more, she now makes a better profit and is better able to provide for the orphans.
Okay, she was given a loan last year and she has already paid back the loan. And last month, her group and her team requested for them to be given another loan. Yeah.
Okay, she's saying that she is happy as well. And she would like to see more women, more guardians being assisted with the loan program other than just herself. Yeah, so it's happening.
Another example of potential power of a microloan can be seen in such businesses as this one. Rose runs a tailor shop. She is a widow with two children in a public secondary school and two children attending this primary school at Faraha. Because of the microloan, she is not only able to pay for the fees of the secondary public school and sustain her family, but she is able to grow her business. When Rose first started her business, she worked by herself with one assistant. The microloan allowed her to invest in more stock, make more profit, and employ six workers. She has already paid back the first loan and hopes to receive a second to buy another sewing machine. The microloan program is not only helping one family, but several.
Hey,
you saying it too?
Won't be high. Won't be high. How are you?
The success of Faraha Community Center is unquestionable, but as the leaders will tell you, they still face many challenges ahead. Patrick, who is in the primary school nursery, has been given a chance at an early age, and his mom is HIV positive, taking part in their healthcare AIDS clinic. There are so many Patricks out there with parents and guardians eager to make a difference in the slum of Aruma.
In our center, we have got around 550. But in Aruma community, the orphans are more than 10,000.
Patrick likes learning his ABCs. To see him is to see hope. The leaders of Faraha Community Center have reached their maximum capacity.
Now we need to create room for more. So expansion will be something that needs to be worked on.
Though they need initial funding, it is their goal to be self-sustaining and to generate income.
Basically, having internet cafe in our center will definitely generate some small income for the center.
But their most immediate challenge and goal as of the summer of 2008 was to provide a daily feeding program at the school.
So having a feeding program is our topmost desire at the moment.
Many of the kids go hungry each day. The lack of nutrition makes their immune system low, and they are unable to concentrate in school. Thankfully, as of October 2008, with the continued support of many people, churches, and businesses, the Faraha Community Center has now launched a daily feeding program for the orphans. Amazingly enough, just $50 can feed over 400 kids one meal. Chris, Dan, David, Carrie, the Faraha Community Center, and so many orphans and families have come a long way on an amazing journey that still seems to only be beginning.
God is good and God is able. So in everything that we do, in every situations that we go through, we must always put God first. And the best thing ever to do is to try to shape our mindset, to try to walk according to God's will, and to try to chase God's kingdom. That's all. That's all that matters. That's all I want to tell everyone that is listening to me right now.
Look down from a broken sky, traced out by the city lights. My world from a mile high, best seat in the house tonight. Touch down in the cold black top, hold on for the sudden stop. Breathe in the familiar shock of confusion and chaos. All those people going somewhere. Why have I never cared? Give me your eyes for just one second. Give me your eyes so I can see everything that I keep missing. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, the ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see. Yeah. 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 Step out on a busy street, see a girl and our eyes meet. Does her best to smile at me, to hide what's underneath. There's a man just to her right, black suit and a bright red tie. Too ashamed to tell his wife he's out of work, he's buying time. All those people going somewhere. Why have I never cared? Give me your eyes for just one second. Give me your eyes so I can see everything that I keep missing. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, the ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see. Yeah. 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 I've been here a million times, a couple of million eyes, just moving past me by. I swear I never thought that I was wrong. Well, I want a second glance, so give me a second chance to see the way you've seen the people all along. Give me your eyes for just one second. Give me your eyes so I can see everything that I keep missing. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, the ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see. Give me your eyes, Lord, give me your eyes so I can see for everything that I keep missing. Give me your heart for the broken hearted.